Yeah.
This is an important question, of course. What can one do to maximize one's chances of making the cut, so to speak, being around long enough, healthy enough for these technologies to arrive to actually postpone ill health of old age indefinitely? And the bad news is that at the moment, we've basically got nothing. That's not completely true, because if you happen to be unlucky, if you happen to have drawn some short straws genetically, so to speak, so that, for example, you are the sort of person who would come down with type 2 diabetes in your 30s, there are such people, then there do seem to be things that we can do to help normalize your rate of aging in that particular way, so that that may indeed considerably extend your healthy lifespan. Also, of course, there are plenty of well-known ways to shorten one's lifespan, smoking, getting overweight, for example, and avoiding those works, but that's not something I need to tell you, of course. So if we ask the more pertinent question, what can we do today that may not be obvious, you know, what unusual supplements might there be that might add 10 years to life, for example, there just aren't any. The evidence is pretty overwhelming that nothing really exists that can help in this way. So I think that actually the best thing that people can do today to maximize their chances of being around long enough for these therapies is simply to work at the other end of the equation. In other words, to do what they can to hasten the development of these therapies. And of course, different people can do that in different ways. If you run a podcast, you can have me on the show so that I can educate you and your listeners, and maybe some of them will have some things that they can do. If you're a scientist, of course, you can get into the right areas of biotechnology so that you can help actually on the ground, so to speak, at the coalface, to develop these things. You know, different people can do different things, but everybody can do advocacy. Everybody can talk to their friends and colleagues and neighbors and family about these things, and generally get people to understand more properly what we are actually trying to do, so that they no longer have these really appalling knee-jerk reactions, negative reactions to something that, in fact, when you understand it, is unequivocally a good thing.
Well, speaking of genetically unfortunate people, since Ray Kurzweil developed diabetes in his late 30s or early 40s, he would probably qualify as being one of those. However, he was arguably successful at reprogramming his biology after taking over 200 different types of supplements each and every day, and supposedly was able to cure himself from diabetes. Furthermore, in his latest book together with Terry Grossman called Transcend, he puts forward a 9-step program which, in his opinion, would allow us, or those of us who decide to follow the program, to basically live long enough to live forever. And yet, somehow, that seems to be at odds with what you just said, isn't it?
Yes, I think it's fair to say that I do somewhat disagree with Ray and Terry on that score. I think that they are rather over-optimistic about the effect that today's therapies can have, today's supplements and so on, can have on people who are already of average health and therefore who are in line to get to the age of 80 in pretty good health, whatever they do. I think that perhaps Ray has been swayed too much by his own success as a result, as you say, of having been able to keep his diabetes at bay for 30 years, having come down with it very young. But I want to emphasize that I very strongly agree with what Ray, especially, and also Terry, say about subsequent work. That you mentioned that they describe the things that we can do today as a bridge to future technologies, and I completely agree with that. I think that their bridge two, which is essentially biotechnology, is precisely what's going to happen. In fact, they largely echo the types of biotechnology that I have been particularly emphasizing. And I also agree with their bridge three, the increasing use of what we might call non-biological solutions to medical problems. I think that's also going to happen down the road. But I think in the short term, the benefits that average people will get from things that, from supplements and such like that we can take already, are really very slight. One might get a year if one's very lucky. And of course, that's better than nothing. So I'm definitely not saying that people shouldn't do what Ray and Terry say, or what other people say that they should do. I think the only thing I would really say is that it's very important not to generalize too much. The single most important piece of advice in terms of one's health that I can give anybody is to pay attention to your own body, to be as knowledgeable as you can, yes, but ultimately not to just do what a book tells you, overriding what seems to work, seems to make you feel healthy.
And what about Ray's claim that he has managed to successfully reprogram his body's biology?
I think that in terms of his own biology, that's a somewhat melodramatic description, perhaps, but strictly speaking, I wouldn't really argue with it. I think that diabetes is a very pervasive disease. It's something that affects the whole of one's metabolism in one way or another. And if one can reset one's diabetic state, then I think that's a reasonable description of reasonably be described as reprogramming one's biology, yes.
Since we're already discussing Ray Kurzweil, this is probably the best time to ask you, how do you think the technological singularity relates to your work?
The relationship between the technological singularity and my work is something that has many dimensions to it, in fact. So many that actually I have been occasionally persuaded to actually give a talk specifically comparing those two things. You probably know that some years ago I identified a concept that I named longevity escape velocity, which is basically the point, the development of incremental refinements to the rejuvenation biotechnologies that I'm working on at a sufficient rate that we essentially stay one step ahead of the problem indefinitely. So when we, for example, develop technologies that can postpone the ill health of old age by 30 years, when they are applied to people who are already in middle age, let's say 60, that means that we'll be taking people who are 60 and rejuvenating them fairly well so that they won't be biologically 60 again until they are chronologically 90. And if we can achieve longevity escape velocity, what that means is that in those 30 years, we will improve those technologies sufficiently so that when they are chronologically 90, even though they are intrinsically harder to rejuvenate because the types of damage that are present in the body will predominantly be ones that the therapies didn't work on, nevertheless, the technologies will have been improved by an amount that outweighs that so that we can re-rejuvenate them more thoroughly the second time than we could the first time. Okay, so that's longevity escape velocity. And a couple of years ago, a friend of mine said, well, we really need a word for the point at which we reach longevity escape velocity, the point at which we start to develop and improve these technologies faster than the damage is catching up with us. And he liked to call that point the Methuselarity. I rather like that word. It's a bit hard to say, but obviously it has echoed the singularity. So the question then is, what are the similarities and differences between the singularity and the Methuselarity? And I think they're quite interesting. The thing about the Methuselarity in terms of its actual technological function is that it's actually rather undramatic compared to the singularity, which of course is very dramatic when we go from having computers that are fairly clever to suddenly having computers that are pretty much infinitely clever. In the Methuselarity, basically we just carry on incrementally improving things, and eventually we're improving them a little bit faster than before, and it's fast enough to stay one step ahead of the problem. And the result, however, is the other way around. The human impact of the singularity may be very slight because we will go from having computers that are already extremely clever and which we don't really have to treat as computers in the way that at least the pioneers of computing used to think of computers. We'll go from there to a point where that just becomes a little bit more true and computers are so clever that they blend even more thoroughly into our background. Whereas in the case of the Methuselarity, the effect will be extraordinarily dramatic. We'll go from being able to stay healthy just a little bit longer and a little bit longer and then going into age-related decline just as we do today, to a point where suddenly we are not in prospect of going into age-related ill health however long we live. So the comparisons and contrasts are actually quite dramatic, and I think it's quite useful to think of those things. I'm glad you asked the question.
And since we're kind of on the topic, what do you think about the blending between biology and technology?
I think the blending of, if you like, non-biological silicon-based technology with biology is going to be a very large part of what I described earlier as the use of non-biological solutions for medical problems. Of course, we're already very familiar with a couple of very nice cases of non-biological solutions. Probably the one that's talked about most is the cochlear implant, which is used to restore hearing to people who have got certain types of profound deafness. And I think that some people are predicting at this point that within only a few years, the quality of cochlear implants will rise so rapidly that people who have those things will actually be able to hear better than people with natural hearing. So that's going to be pretty interesting. The possibility of concert pianists deliberately having, you know, elective insertion of cochlear implants may come along, for example. So I think that's a sort of, you know, a proof of concept of the idea. And it seems pretty clear that miniaturization of a variety of different non-biological technologies, including medical ones, is something that's going to carry on happening. And of course, the logical endpoint of that miniaturization process is molecular manufacturing, which is something that has certainly been applied theoretically to a whole variety of different medical problems, especially by the enormously comprehensive work of Rob Freitas and Ralph Merkel.
And what about the potential impact of medical nanobots or the alleged transition of our species as a predominantly biologically based species to one that could potentially migrate to become a virtual or a silicon-based one?
I haven't been investigating that myself, no. I like to keep up with it. I'm always very interested when I hear lectures on that topic from my friends and colleagues in the field, but I've got my hands full with the straightforward biotechnological work at the moment.